thank you everybody for offering me such wonderful opportunity to present one of my recent research papers at a significant conference of GIRES. I'm J.Chakraborty, Chakraborty, a PhD candidate in the Department of English and Culture Studies at Bankura University, West Bengal, India. I'm also a member of Modern Language Association. The title of my presentation is Racial Violence in Contemporary American Poetry, from Explicit Violence to Microaggression. Introduction. Racial violence in America. Racial violence in America undoubtedly has a long history. It's noticeable, for example, in number one, the racially motivated collective violence against Afro-Americans before the American Civil War that lasted from 1861 to 1865. And during the era of Reconstruction, violence was also committed against Afro-Americans in relation to the institution of Jim Crow laws. Number two, the conflict between Asian Americans and white Americans during and after the Gold Rush that started in 1848. Number three, the anti-immigrant violence against Latin Americans in the 20th century. Number four, the attacks on Native Americans and white Americans, California genocide, Indian massacres, and so on. Literary scholarship on racial violence. Given the long history of racial violence in America, racial violence in American literature has received a good deal of scholarly attention. Scholars have usually focused on the historical trauma of African Americans in American literature, the racially motivated incidents of lynching in it, the Gothic elements in Afro-American literature, the role of the materially bounded individualism in perpetrating racial violence, and so on. Examples of scholarly works. Reading Testimony, Witnessing Trauma, Confronting Race, Gender, and Violence in American Literature by Eden Wells Friedman explores the historical trauma in African American literature and how both the narrated and the reader can witness such trauma together. Race, Rape, and Lynching, The Red Record of American Literature, 1890 to 1912, by Sandra Gunning, investigates various racial stereotypes in American literature at the turn of the 20th century, connected to white and black lynching. African American Gothic, Screams from Shadowed Places, by Maissa Western, examines how African American fiction critics and appropriates the racial ideologies and mechanisms of the Gothic genre to articulate the unique terror and complexity of African-American existence. Thinking the Body Transcendent, Racial Violence and the Mystical Imaginary in Contemporary American Literature by Eric Samuel Sierra indicates that recent American literature challenges the prevalent notion of individualism that disavows otherness in society and can unleash racial and ideological violence. Gap in recent scholarship. The recent scholarship on racial violence in American literature, however, does not consider the nuances of racial violence in American literature. It exclusively focuses on the explicit form of racial violence. More precisely, the word violence signifies the use of physical force in such scholarship. But racial violence can also be very subtle. Under certain circumstances, racial violence is difficult to understand and requires a much more sophisticated interpretive framework than has been provided by this scholarship. The recent scholarship also ignores the connection of the foregoing nuances to American citizenship and identity. Aims of this article and their contemporary significance: to examine both the explicit form of racial violence and its subtle form of microaggression by analyzing two points: Don't Let Me Be Lonely, an American Lyric, and Citizen, an American Lyric, by Claudia Rankine, a contemporary American poet. Also to examine the complicated relationship of racial violence to American citizenship and identity, and the solutions these texts propose to the problem of racial violence. The contemporary significance of these two aims lies in the fact that they develop a new consciousness of racial violence in scholarship on American literature, and that such consciousness can promote a new approach to racism, citizenship, and identity in the American society. Methodology. First, I employ the two relevant definitions of violence according to Merriam-Webster. Number one, the use of physical force so as to injure, abuse, damage, or destroy. Number two, vehement feeling or expression, fervor. Secondly, I consider the validity of critical race theory, which contends that racism is conditioned by social and institutional interactions that are subtle, complex, and shifting. This theory is significant in that it seeks to understand any subtle form of racial violence. However, it is also accused of social constructionism that elevates storytelling over evidence and reason. My methodology embraces the positive aspect of critical race theory and discards its negative aspect. This methodology also stresses evidence and reason. Textual analysis. Don't Let Me Be Lonely, an American lyric. Claudia Rankine is a contemporary American poet, essayist, playwright, and editor of Jamaican origin. She has authored 5 volumes of poetry, 2 plays, and various essays. She is also the winner of several awards like Los Angeles Times Book Award 2014, National Book Critics Circle Awards 2015, and so on. Don't Let Me Be Lonely is a multimedia prose poem that brilliantly depicts the trauma of life in the post-9/11 American society, both at the individual and at the collective levels, through a fragmented narrative. Some sections of the poem deal with 3 incidents that are compatible with the first definition of violence, that is, the use of physical force so as to injure, abuse, damage, or destroy, and that seem to be connected to race. The first incident concerns the murder of an African-American named James Byrd Jr. by 3 white supremacists who offered him a ride home in a pickup truck. But instead of bringing him home, they beat him at a clearing in the woods, chained him to the back of the truck, and drove it in a different direction. Police later found his body parts that stretched for 2 miles. The second incident is concerned with police brutality. Violence was perpetrated against Abner Luma, a Haitian immigrant arrested in front of Club Rendezvous, in Brooklyn on Saturday, August 9, 1997, and sodomized with a broken broomstick in police custody. One of the perpetrators, Officer Justin Ball, pleaded guilty and was sentenced to jail for 30 years. The third also concerns police brutality and entails Ahmed Diallo, an unarmed West African immigrant and street vendor, shot dead on February 4, 1999 by 4 police officers. The text, along with the endnotes, details these incidents, but interestingly, though all these incidents could fall into the category of racially motivated violence in its explicit form, the text does not specifically indicate the racial motivation and encourages the readers to exercise their own logic and imagination to fully conceptualize these incidents. These incidents produce a complex effect on the speaker's psyche and identity. They appeal to the nihilistic private self of her on the one hand and encourage in her an intellectual sublimation of her feelings of oppression as an American citizen of a minority community at the social level on the other. arguably the second incident that, as the text indicates, receives judicial condemnation, reinforces this point. Textual analysis, Citizen and American Lyric. Like Don't Let Me Be Lonely, Citizen and American Lyric is also a mixed media collection of poems, photographs, vignettes, and reproductions of various forms of visual art. The text represents the implicit form of racial violence, that is, violence as it signifies in the second definition of Merriam-Webster, through various and numerous incidents in the everyday life of any black citizen of America. For example, one day when the black protagonist, referred to as you, takes a test at her Catholic school as a child, a white girl behind her asks her to lean over so that the girl could copy her answers. The protagonist obliges by leaning over, but is astonished to find that the teacher has not noticed the girl's act, though it would be quite obvious. The protagonist concludes that either the teacher does not care about cheating, or she considers the protagonist as someone invisible. In another case, Never warns the protagonist against a menacing black guy walking around her house. The protagonist explains that the person in question is a friend, and that the neighbor is also familiar with him, but the neighbor has already called the police. In yet another case, a woman at work calls the protagonist by another woman's name, but the co-worker's apology note calls the incident our mistake, connoting that your own invisibility is a real problem causing her confusion. By reference to Judith Butler, the narrator examines the aggressive nature of racist language. We learn that our condition of being addressable makes racist language not an agent of erasure, but an agent of hypervisibility. The narrator also metaphysically ruminates on the nature of black American identity. She contends that the more we understand its true nature, the more we feel its pathetically marginalized condition in American society. The narrator historically grounds her arguments. She refers to the black communities along the Gulf Coast that national relief organizations all but ignored and ultimately failed to properly serve after Hurricane Katrina devastated the area and left many people homeless. Moreover, she refers to the deaths of some black men who were murdered due to their skin color, such as Trayvon Martin and James Craig Anderson. Significance of my finding. Racial violence may not be always explicit. The implicit form of racial violence or microaggression may produce a more damaging effect on the human psyche than its explicit counterpart. In Rankine, racial violence is associated with American citizenship and identity in a complicated way, while the explicit form usually receives condemnation from the American judicial system and thus by implication strengthens the liberal values of American citizens. The implicit form often goes unnoticed by liberal Americans and has a pervasive, toxic impact on American society. While the second point seeks to promote a genial approach to human life with engagement in social issues, the first point strikes a more concrete and optimistic note regarding the issue of equality and freedom. Influenced by Emmanuel Levinas, it proposes the idea of being for the other, the idea that the other should be prioritized in social existence as a solution to various problems in American society, including the problem of racial violence. These two solutions are complementary. The lack of any concrete solution and the pervasively bleak tone in the second point suggest that the issue of implicit violence is much more problematic than the issue of explicit violence. My examination of the two points by Rankine develops a a new consciousness of racial violence in scholarship on American literature. Such consciousness can promote a new approach to American racism, citizenship, and identity in the non-literary social discourses, for example, the discourse of civil rights in particular, and in the American society as a whole. Thank you.